Hello. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Rita McGrath, and I'm a professor at the Columbia Business School in the city of New York. And I'd like to share with you today some of the ideas that are in my book, The End of Competitive Advantage: How to Keep Your Strategy Moving as Fast as Your Business. And the book is an attempt to bring the thinking of strategy into the modern era. If you think about it, a lot of our tools for strategy and a lot of our frameworks and mental models for strategy are based on a core concept which has been called sustainable competitive advantage. And the idea was that you discovered an attractive position within your industry and then created entry barriers around that position so that you could defend it from possible competition and enjoy that position for a long, long time. The primary drivers were considered to be defensive, so you defended your advantages against competition. And what we've learned in the years since those tools were first created is that for many parts of our economy, the prescriptions coming out of that world simply don't apply. If you think about the era in which a lot of management tools were created, they were conceived in the 60s, in the 70s, even in the 80s, when the world was a very different place. From the perspective of American companies, you know, China was closed, India was closed, Latin America wasn't really a player on the global stage, and so there was very little of the kind of competition we see today, where there are very few barriers to entry, where a lot of commerce is transparent and global, and of course where digitization has created entirely different competitive conditions than the ones those tools were designed for. So my argument is that what we need to become more adept in, what our companies really need to get better at doing, is competing in the world of what I call transient advantage, where advantages come, are built up, but then eventually they come under pressure and they create the urgent need for organizations to shift their resources and shift their activities from what they were doing that had created an advantage in the past to something that could be a possibility for the future. We're changing the way that we need to think about strategy is we're shifting from a view of industry as the fundamental boundary around which we design our goals to a view of arenas as the fundamental playing field. Now, what do I mean by an arena? What I mean by an arena is that it's a space in which various players from various industries may be contesting our goals. They may be contesting for the pot of resources that we need, or they may be contesting for the raw materials we need, or they may simply be making what we do unnecessary or less relevant. And I think it's very interesting when you look at strategy that way because it changes how you think about who your real competition is. So if you think about a new playbook for strategy, which is consistent with this idea that strategies come and strategies go, it would look very different. So I think six distinct differences in how we've thought about strategy in the past versus how we need to be thinking of it today are key. The first is to stop thinking about stability as the normal thing and start thinking about continuously reconfiguring your capabilities, your people, your assets in an ongoing basis as the necessary and normal thing. You know, human beings kind of like to snap back to, thank God that's over, we don't need to change. And yet, if you continually make small changes to refresh your advantage, to keep things current, what you'll find, because they accumulate, is over a period, they add up to quite substantial changes. What you want to avoid is this lurching from crisis to crisis that we so often see in companies that are not prepared to deal with temporary advantages. So continuous reconfiguration is a first principle. Secondly, we have the need to create the conditions for healthy disengagement of something that just isn't working. And very often what I find is companies will cling far, far too long to a line of offer, to a line of goods, to an innovation, because they're hoping against hope that it will someday turn around and return to its former glory. The third principle is that you really want to separate out the resource allocation process in your company from the power process in your company. So that's the problem. When you've got an entrenched business leader with a business to defend, they're not going to free up budget to put into something else. They're going to use that budget to defend. So you want to have what I call deft resource allocation. You want to be able to take resources from a business that, you know, maybe doesn't merit more investment and move it into businesses that are a better fit with your strategy or a better fit with growth. An interesting example of a company that did this very well is Procter & Gamble under the guidance of A.G. Lafley, their CEO today. He was their CEO in the past, but he went through the portfolio of the company and made some very difficult decisions about divesting certain brands. One of them was Jif peanut butter, a beloved American peanut butter brand. But Lafley had said, look, my strategy is about big global brands that are representative everywhere. Only Americans eat peanut butter. So he decided to exit Jif, and there were howls of protest, but you know, P&G turned out to be better off, and the company that eventually bought the brand is doing a fine job with it. The fourth element of this new playbook for strategy has to do with innovation. And I mean innovation quite broadly. Innovation certainly in technologies, but also in ways of doing business, ways of attracting customers, ways of making life simpler or cheaper, and certainly today, ways of connecting and communicating that are unprecedented in human history. You know, the whole rise of social media, the rise of networks of customers are creating really unprecedented challenges to firms that are working in a more traditional way. So we want to make innovation an actual proficiency. You need to see innovation in many of the different activities of your organization. Things that are new, that create value, that keep your company competitive. And it can't just be left to a few people, and it can't just be random, and it can't just be episodic. And that's a big problem I see all the time, that there's an enthusiasm for innovation and people run around having innovation boot camps, and then eventually it kind of fades away because there's not a real process around it. So you need a process for building innovation into the very core of what you're doing as a company. Then we come to leadership. And here's where I think a lot of companies really struggle, because historically, the role of the leader was to chart a path and to know where we were going and to project what would happen and then to deliver on those projections. Well, in a world that's moving faster and that has fewer certainties about it, increasingly the role of the leader is to be able to get disconfirming information, to be able to change direction, as that information would suggest you can do, and to be able to shift our goals. So perhaps we've learned that original goal wasn't really going to deliver the results that we needed. Perhaps we learned that this particular set of technologies doesn't really have application to that kind of problem. Maybe it needs to be handling this kind of problem. And this is placing entirely new demands on leaders. Candor, being willing to hear the difficult information, being very honest about what's actually going on, these are going to be very critical. Lastly, I think we need to all think very seriously about what this means for careers. Because in many companies, the traditional connection between the employer and the employee has either broken down completely or it's in the process of breaking down. So historically, companies were willing to invest huge amounts of resource in training and educating people. And why were they willing to do that? Because they had a reasonable expectation that some portion of those people would be with the company for a long time. So I think we're looking at a completely new kind of career. And I think companies are going to have to get a lot smarter about what that means. So we're going less from a world where you traded loyalty in exchange for security, or you traded a long-term job in exchange for, you know, having that career ladder, to a world where it's much more about tours of duty and individual plans. It's much more about, you know, let's understand the alliance that we're creating. So it's not employer-employee, it's employee with desirable attributes, employer forming an alliance. If it's not successful for both parties. It's just not going to work. And I think this is going to put enormous pressure on your human resource systems, on your personnel systems, and on the way you go about acquiring talent. Now, is this all a recipe for despair? Is there any good news here at all? I would argue yes, there's terrific news. The fact that things are so much less settled makes for enormous entrepreneurial opportunity. If you talk to the young programmers in Silicon Valley or you come to New York and look at the incubators that are there, you see nothing but optimism. People are very excited about some of the activities that these are going to open up for them. And I think for careers, it also creates lots of opportunity. You can change careers. You can learn new skills. You can build out your network and become more valuable. So I think rather than thinking mournfully, I think it's a lot smarter and a lot more fun to be thinking about how do I make a way in an environment which is offering me lots of opportunities, even as it's causing some of the old traditions to fade away. So that's the essence of the book. It's trying to paint a picture of this new world and how you can become an effective participant in it. Thank you very much.